I want to spend the rest of this year, even preachers that I invite to preach here, dealing with the Holy Spirit. And I wanted to deal with it because I was talking with the sister minister, and I said, well, we couldn't really think back in history where the church spent a lot of time teaching about the Holy Spirit. And then when we talk about it, we normally talk about it in ways that were not beneficial to the text, to the teaching of the Holy Spirit.
Man.
And the reason is I have a conviction that there's too much emphasis on having done right as according to the law, but not having fulfilled the relationship that we ought to have with the Holy Spirit. And so since we seldom hear about the Holy Spirit, we seldom think about our spiritual condition. We certainly don't recall times when we look at ourselves and we examine ourselves and how our spirit relates to the Spirit of Christ. And so we live a life in the church in which we know a lot of law. And we become pragmatists. We fight, we fuss, we check people, we spend our time evaluating whether or not we're going to do something or not do something, never considering what spirit it came from. Because I'm unaware of spiritual teaching. I'm unaware that every day that I get up out of my bed, that there is a force, a great divine force, who has something special for you to lead you to. And there's another force, a lesser force, a demonic force, whose intention is to take over and to lead you somewhere else that Christ would not have led you.
Amen.
So I live my life following me through the day, and I find myself sometime in the same situation I was in yesterday. Because I'm not mentally aware that from the time I got out of my bed, something didn't want me to give God glory. Something when I got out of my bed made me complain about my big toe or my back or made me think about problems. Not maybe, but helped me to get along the thought process. But I didn't get out of my bed and say, glory, thank you, Jesus, for waking me up this morning.
Man.
And I slow down and I come to realize that, to understand, and I've said this, and I want somebody else to preach it, but a church that won't praise God. Mm-hmm. Let me say it again. But a church that don't have the Spirit of God, a church that's struggling with the Spirit of God, need to be concerned with its relationship with God.
Man.
Folk out of there will come into the house of God,
yes,
as they're passing by and see and feel the Spirit of God,
man,
in the people of God.
Yes, sir.
This is why Paul is walking through. He says, I came to Apollos, and as I came to Corinth, I hit this business metropolitan area. In fact, he's in the Zenith area, and he sees people, and I want you to see this very, very quickly. He'll see a group of people. Now, Luke is the author of the book of Acts. Luke is the first to identify Christianity. Luke is the first to fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah chapter 9 that they shall be called by a new name. Baptist couldn't have been. Those other names had already been used, but Luke is the first to use a name that had never been used. And he said they were called Christians first.
Man. You know
what I'm saying?
Man.
I want to show you something very quickly. But in Acts chapter 19, he does not identify after their Pentecost these people as Christians.
Yes, sir.
He identifies them as disciples. Okay. Let's see if I can help you with this.
Great.
We know they had been baptized.
Uh-huh.
Since they were baptized, they ought to be identified.
Yes.
As Christians.
Man.
But let's look at the verse. And finding certain disciples.
Right.
How folk that have been baptized still identify as disciples?
Following Christ.
How is it that in Acts chapter 11, you call them Christians first and then them? But down the road, you came to another group of people who have been baptized but are identified as disciples. And it caused me to start thinking just for a minute, because the author seems to be saying that there could be, no, he's not seen to be, because he didn't
spells it out. He says in the next three verses why it is he says it exists. But could it be by application that there are some of you that have been baptized, but you still are disciples?
Well,
and have not yet became Christ-like. Some of us may have been baptized because my mom and my dad and my sister, my brother. Some of you may have been baptized because they had some emotional things. Or some of you got baptized because a marriage was in place. Some of you got baptized for a myriad of reasons of John's baptism. But how many of you received the Holy Ghost?
Well,
their response to him was, as disciples, that we haven't so much as
heard.
And I wonder, how many sermons have you heard about the Holy Ghost?
Well,
and if you were baptized according to Acts chapter 2 and verse number 38, because I'm not talking about being filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm not talking about that because that's denominationalism. I'm talking about having received the Holy Ghost. Acts 2 verse number 38, the Bible says that we that they repented and were baptized, and the Bible says that you shall receive the what? The gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promise is not only unto you, but to everyone else afar off. And so in the church, we receive the Holy Ghost,
man.
We're not filled with the Holy Ghost.
Man.
The apostles were filled with the Holy Ghost, and by the laying of hands, they were able to spread the gifts of the Holy Ghost and the Spirit, but you should have received the Holy Ghost. And the only thing that stopped one from receiving the Holy Ghost is the fact that they never heard of the Holy Ghost in the first place.
Man.
You heard about the church. You heard about one Lord and one faith and one baptism. But you have never been told that in order to live this life in Ephesians 4 and verse 4, there's also one Spirit. And in order to break the bondages of Satan, you have to be in line with that Spirit. And that Spirit has a job that has been left for you and I by Jesus Christ himself. And without that Spirit, you'll never be empowered by the Holy Ghost.
Man. Man.
Amen. So I started looking around, I started wondering for the last two or three weeks. I'm talking to the older priests, and I'm talking to them. I said, man, what's wrong with the churches? I've never seen people fight about Bible class. I've never thought in the history of Christianity folk would be fighting about doing spiritual work. I never thought I'd hear Church of Christ folk sit down and argue about the minutest thing. You have thousands of people dying every day, and we spend our time talking about no written clapping. What's wrong with people? The people are dying, losing their soul in these denominational churches, and you're talking about somebody preaching on me. What's wrong with you? The whole content and the existence of Christianity is not that Christianity is a matter of laws and rules and direction, but Christianity to reflect the Spirit of Christ, for you are Christ-like than anything else when we use the name Christianity.
Man.
Now, I'm tired of folks who say they're Christians, but you don't see any Christ in them at all. Y'all say amen? And so perhaps when Paul came through, he saw folk who assembled every Sunday. He saw folk that had their Bibles out. He saw folk that were looking for Jesus. He saw folk that were sitting down and saying, yeah, we got baptized. Well, that's it. We saw folk, he said, those are not Christians, but those are
disciples.
Because the disciple is simply a follower of Christ. And I stop by to tell you, you can't do spiritual work with disciples of Christ. You have to do spiritual work with Christians. That's Christ-like folk who have the mind of Christ.
Man.
To serve and do the work of Christ. Well, Christ comes first.
Freak.
And not their own life.
Freak.
I said, man, so I'm like, look, I said, well, no, you know the difference between a Christian and a disciple. Y'all all right?
Man.
Y'all all right? Y'all all right?
Yes, sir.
Are you this morning, are you a Christian or a disciple? Are you at church in the Lord's house? And you're imitating and you're looking at Christianity from a physical and sociological perspective. You give from the liturgical commands of the scriptures. You attend because you don't want to go to hell. You do certain things because at a certain time, it's time to do. Do you spend your time finding yourself deciding exactly what it is you're going to do, when you're going to do it, and how you're going to do it? Is Christianity only some place important you come to in life that's significant on Sunday morning, but insignificant through the week? My friend, that is discipleship, because one can always say, I'm following Christ. I haven't reached the point of Christ. But I believe that we follow the example of Christ. As I said it this morning, in Philippians 2 and verse number 5, that we ought to have a mindset that has the mind of Christ. A Christian thinks like Christ.
and not heard.
Right now, right now. Some of you, let me tell you, you learning. Let me tell you, learning. But y'all need to praise God.
Man.
Y'all need, you need to praise God. If there's an answer God in you, and you're here to preach the word of God, you ought to look like it. I don't care what folks have taught you. You ought to look like you receive the word of God. But here's the problem. If I'm talking to disciples, members, they don't connect with the word of God. So when they hear the word of God, there's no response from the people of God. Supposed people of God. Folk who hear the word of God.
Uh-huh.
The Bible said, let the redeemed
say amen.
Say something.
Man.
If somebody here has been saved, sanctified, full of the Holy Ghost, can't you say something?
Yes,
everybody here. Let's hear y'all say something. If anybody in the house of God that God has done something for,
uh-huh.
When folk pass through, and I'm not sure I'm a few in the house yes, of God. But it ought to sound like people are praising God in spirit and in truth. And every now and then when you hear a verse or something that sounds right, you ought to be able to say, thank you, Jesus, and amen in the house of God.
Three.
Yes, y'all, sometimes it's too cool for the Holy Spirit to get in and move around. I'm going to show what I mean just a minute because there's one thing I made in my mind I would do. But since what I said I would do, two things I'm not going to do. Number one, when I find people who are not filled with the Spirit, and full of themselves, uh-huh. I'm not going to be arguing with them.
Man.
Because they don't have the Spirit of God, they don't hear you anyway. Can y'all say amen?
Amen.
And what did Paul say in 1 Corinthians chapter 3? Right, the third verse says, I spoke to you with the Spirit, but you didn't receive it.
Yep.
So I had to speak to you accordingly because you understand worldly stuff more than you understand the Spirit of God. When you run into people, when you pass by Corinth to the palace, Apollos passed through Corinth, and you run into people, and you such as have you do such by Holy Ghost talking and spiritual talking, they don't even understand what you're talking about. They start frowning up and looking and rolling out because they have a spiritual encounter of the closest kind, and you're talking about something now that's foreign to them. They don't even get what you're talking about because they have not received the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And so they were honest. And the text said, "What did you know what they said? You know what they said?
We have heard
so much
as heard of the Holy Spirit.
That there's a Holy Spirit. I want to talk to you about the dangers of not hearing about the Holy Spirit. When we have never heard of the Holy Spirit, we lose the attributes of the Godhead in our life. We lose the very essence of the Holy Spirit functions that God has left for us. The Greek word, the parokletos, means one who is called aside to help us. A person who is born of the Holy Spirit has no one alongside of him to help him. A woman, he or she, that does not know and understand the Holy Spirit loses the attributes of the Holy Spirit. The other definition says it is one who has been called to defend us. Well, if I'm all alone, naturally, I now have no one to defend me because every now and again in church, we need some defending in the house of God. Y'all say amen.
Yeah.
And when you don't even know your defender, when he's standing right beside you, you show up in a world of trouble. We find the same word is used in 1 John chapter 2 and verse number 1. My little children, if one of you sin, if one of you fall short, if one of you come short of the glory of God, and sure enough, some of you have fallen short of the glory of God. Sure enough, every one of us have come short of the glory of God.
Man.
The reason that you let shame take over in your life, and the reason that you feel demise and fall into sin and depression, is that you're not aware that when you sin, that we have an advocate, we have a Savior, we have the Holy Spirit who advocates for us in heaven. Somebody ought to say amen. That's not a worry about folk acting crazy with me, because I know I got the Holy Spirit advocating for me in heaven. Am I right about
it?
I know I got a lawyer. The Bible says he makes for the preparation, which is a legal term. He sets the case. Even if I mess up, there's a Holy Spirit that's arguing my case before God. It's your job when you're led by the Spirit to crucify by the littleness. But when you're led by the BS, you learn to be He said, well, you be not full of the Spirit of God. He said, let me tell you something. 1 John 2, my little children, these things I write unto you that you what? That you may not what? That you may not do. Not because of the Spirit, you may not see it. Yo, hey, look at this. I need five people full of the Spirit. I'll be rest alone. Full of the Spirit, have churches for me.
Man.
Amen.
Man.
Amen. Because there are those folks that connected to the Holy Spirit. I mean, five people came to church, not worried about trying to see how you're going to check the preacher, be preacher, and make sure you preach it right. Because I ain't got time for that. I'm going to leave you right where you are, on that pew, missing all this good food. You're going to sit right there. That's why I see God's spirit folk. That's all they do. That's all church folk do is fight. Because they don't have a spirit. They crazy. They'll sit up in the house of God and be looking around, looking all mad and crazy, trying to disrupt the spiritual work of the Lord. Don't let them get you. Don't let them get you. Somebody sitting looking right now, looking outside the law. Move over one seat.
Amen.
Praise God. Because you came here to have a close encounter with the Spirit of the Lord.
Amen.
And folks who have the Spirit of God don't come in the house of God acting like the spirit of the devil. Folks that don't have the Spirit of God will praise God. Y'all say amen. Amen. Folks that don't realize that it was the Holy Spirit that you keep not acknowledging that's defending you. The only reason you might be in right now, you know you did it. Look at your lady and say you did it.
You did it.
Tell the truth. That ain't this who said you did it. I did it. That's who. Don't lie to the truth. I did it. If it wasn't for the Holy Spirit, y'all, y'all two y'all the same. Y'all right there, y'all the same. Look at your neighbor and say, I did it. Tell the truth. All right, I'm going to let my son and go heaven. The only reason God had struck down from heaven is because when we see the Holy Spirit advocates.
Man.
Don't you tell me I don't have the Holy Spirit. If it wasn't for the Holy Spirit, I'd have got justice. But because of the work of the Holy Spirit, his job is to defend and to advocate for me.
Yes, sir.
So when I sin, I don't have to just live in that sin and drop my head like there's no hope, because the Holy Spirit resurrects my hope.
Man.
Now that don't make you say thank you, Jesus. We got to change your spirit.
Uh-huh.
Are you all right?
Amen.
He passes by. He finds a group of people who are void of the understanding of the Holy Spirit. They are identified in the distorted mood of them. Yes, indeed. They have not been given the information. Did not know that there was the Holy Spirit. How many people have we baptized who had no idea of the work of the Holy Spirit in their life? That they will come and encounter with the Holy Spirit. One thing about the Holy Spirit is something it'll never do. The Holy Spirit will never help you be taught something and lead you into something wrong.
Man.
If you got the Holy Spirit, you didn't get it nowhere else but in the Church of Christ.
Man.
The Holy Spirit will never do when you ask, have you been baptized? Yeah, I've been baptized. Paul asked the question first. Paul said, have you been baptized? Have you received the gift of the Holy Spirit? They looked at him and said, may we never heard of the Holy Spirit. He said, so what then will you baptize? If you were baptized and it brought you out in some other church, he said, what in the world were you baptized to be? He said, John's baptism, man's teaching. John taught half the story. Jesus rewrote and wrote the rest of the story. For he is the author and the finisher of our soul salvation. So what then were you baptized to?
Man.
The folks sitting here right now who only got half of the job done. They've been baptized in the watery grave. And they got up and they didn't understand why were they just like they were when they went down in the sea. It's because the definition of the paracletos is to say that one now has a spirit that is going to help them mimic Christ. The three definitions, the Holy Spirit helps me mimic Christ. The Holy Spirit defends me when I'm in the era of Christ-like thinking. And the Holy Spirit never leaves me. Jesus said, I'm with thee always, even to the end of the world. Matthew chapter 28, Hebrews chapter 13, and verse number 5. He said, you need to stop covering this stuff from the world. All this money and stuff that you have to. He said, well, I'm with you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. The Holy Spirit, when you receive the Holy Spirit, you have to submit to the Holy Spirit.
know the Spirit's job when I'm sitting in church acting crazy. I don't even know what Spirit I'm in. Because that ain't the Spirit of who?
God.
That's the Spirit of Christ. Because Christ will be acting like that in the house of God. When I get mad and say, you ain't going to tell me nothing. That ain't the Spirit of Christ. That you need to be mad, but I'm not aware. Because I'm in my own spirit. And I can I say this? It is not in me to guide and guard himself, to direct himself. The one thing the Spirit must have is cooperation with the person who's mimicking in Christ. And if you won't subject yourself and submit yourself to the Spirit, you will live your whole life a disciple and never be a Christian. You will find Luke will always know it's a disciple. Here's your question again. Are you a disciple or are you Christ-like? I know you go to church every day. Are you just following Christ? Or you ask those Christ living in you? Let the word of God dwell in you. The Colossians might have said, with all richness, whatever you do in word and deed, do all to the name of the Lord. Are you a Christian or a disciple? Are you a disciple or are you delivered? You can be a disciple and not delivered. Why are you not delivered? Because the Spirit has a job to deliver you. The only Spirit can deliver you is you have to succumb to the Spirit.
Man.
That's it. That makes some sense. Get for me John 16. We'll be about through. Because all of them who's in the Spirit today, and we'll preach more in depth about the Spirit, about blood. John 16. Watch Spirit's job. And so you got to submit to this. Because the Spirit ain't going to make you do nothing. That's why I don't have people telling me that the Spirit made me jump up and do this and all. Now the Spirit, it doesn't react in that way. But the Spirit can show up, help you do what you need to do. But the choice is yours. Amen?
Yeah.
The choice is yours. John 16, starting in verse number 7, but Adam, when you read it, the Bible says what? Nevertheless, I tell you the truth.
It is expedient.
It is expedient.
For you that I go
for
away.
I go away.
For if I go not
if I
away.
Go not away.
The Comforter will not come
unto you. That's the Holy Spirit. The Comforter. That's the Holy Spirit. I'm not trying to get into an argument about the Catholic and the word holy, because that's irrelevant. That's what fighters do. There's a difference in a person full of fight and full of faith. Fighters spend all their time fighting, talking about what ain't right and saying what ain't right. But you stop fighting. It's time to stop fighting. It's time to be full of faith.
Amen.
That's what fighters do. They sit around and fight. They not happy when they say fight. You can't talk to some of y'all because you have a spirit of fighting in you. And all you do is just trying to fight. You fight so much, but you're fighting the Holy Spirit. You're not fighting in your heart. You're fighting with the Holy Spirit. Job is in your life. He said, the Comforter, the Spirit comforts. He will not come unto you.
But if I depart.
I depart. Read.
I will send him unto you.
I will send him unto you. Next verse.
And when he has come.
When he has come. Watch your job. When he's come.
He will reprove
the world. The world of what?
Of sin.
Of sin. Of what?
And of righteousness.
And of righteousness of what?
And of judgment.
And of judgment. Read.
Of sin.
Of sin.
Because they believe not on me.
They believe not on me. Read.
Of righteousness. Because I go to the Father. And ye see me no more.
That's some folks there. That folks are telling you just the other day. That Jesus Christ wasn't the Son of God. That he wasn't the Son of God. That Jesus Christ never said he was the Son of God.
Mm-hmm.
But we know that's a lie, don't we? But I had to fight him because guess what? Talking to that dude who don't have the Spirit of God in him, how are you going to communicate?
Man.
You know what? You can't fix church problems because you both have to be in the same spirit. Here's the correct use of the Bible. Same spirit, same mind, same with Lord. You have to be in the same spirit. That is, God's word is true. And we're going to stand on God's word. And we're going to keep working on God's word until we see God's word the way God would have us to see it, not the way we want to see it. So you can't talk to folk who come with another spirit. Because they have another spirit. When you're talking, it's like blah, 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 blah. Because they have the spirit of fight. And what that person want to do, you want to say, God's word said, so they can look right at the Bible. And they'll turn right around and look at you and roll their eyes and talk about, I talked to somebody else. They said, but did you study the Bible? Did you read for yourself?
Amen.
What did Jesus say?
Amen.
Well, what did God say through his word? Have you looked at his word? We're studying with Brother Riddell and another young man was sitting there, and I went through the scriptures and he received the scriptures and he got that spirit got moving in him and he came back with somebody. They must be a cult. The Spirit has a job, and when they'll reprove the sin, and then I write to submit, I'm a cult. If I'm a cult, I'm on the poorest, pitiful cult on the face of earth. There's nobody standing there. People like me, I don't have a respect. I wish I would.
cult leader has a demonic following. He has people that will lay their legs down here. Now, how many of y'all will die for me? How many of y'all do whatever I tell you to do? See, I told you I wasn't going to call. How many of y'all think I'm God? I'm failing the test. How many think I'm God? How many of y'all tell y'all to send y'all wife to my house? Well, I wish you would. Don't you pray for him? But I was barely got mine. I don't need yours. Amen. It's just crazy. But his answer, his problem, and our problem is when we're combated and faced with the spiritual word of God, we struggle with dealing with the spirit because our spirit has not submitted to the word of God.
Man.
Because my spirit has not submitted to the word of God, I cease to be able to enjoy the definition of the word of the Spirit of God. So my problem is not your problem, nothing, because you have not received the spirit of the Holy Ghost. That's why you've been in church 20 years and can't keep coming to church. That's why you keep struggling in your communion, your relationship with God, because there is a big